been self-sufficient because you never know what kind of, you know, screwball you're going to marry. You know, the guy doesn't have a job and you're going to have to go out pregnant the whole nine yards and, you know, the guy's home playing video games. That's not none of you. So anyway, the dream of every girl, every Jewish girl, was to walk as a virgin to her new home. But something God had in mind was an enormous curveball. Those of us who like baseball. God threw a curveball. He went, he sent the prime minister of heaven, Gabriel, and he went to Mary. And Mary, you're going to have a baby. What do you mean? I'm not even married. Don't worry about that. For the baby you are carrying, the father is going to be the Holy Spirit. He will impregnate you. But how am I going to sell that to the world, right? No, don't worry about that. It's amazing that this happened to this girl. Her dream of a perfect life was just destroyed. Seriously. Because now, the Holy Spirit and Gabriel had to sell that same fact to whom? To Joseph. And when they went to Joseph and told him, hey, listen, this girl is pregnant, you're going to get married. And, what? I'm not going to marry that girl. In fact, the Bible says he thought about it so much that he was going to leave her in private in order not to make, you know, a big scene and humiliate her. He was going to leave her in private. Again, God had to send Gabriel back to this old man at the time because, you know, Joseph was a lot older than Mary, as we know. And you know, hey, you're not going anywhere, Joseph. This is our will for you. You are going to take care of this woman. And throughout all the history of Joseph and Mary and Jesus, it was always seen as an aberration in the family. This is an unwed teenager that got pregnant, and you're, you know, basically, Jesus, you're a bastard. That's a biblical word, by the way. That's what you are, somebody without a father, and your mother played around. And that's why you're like this. Can you imagine the Son of God, millions of angels worshiping him in heaven, millions of angels following this particular child and hearing the slander of all the friends and people all around, all the way into the time when Jesus was almost dead as a human. People were saying stuff about him that was not true and that were unkind. And he still had the likeness. Hey, no problem. My mission is to save you, those people that were killing him. So every Christmas time, when you look at the theological scenario, why God sent his son, when you look at the human dilemma, here is the imperfect couple now, right? The odd couple. Now we gotta go to Egypt because there's this crazy guy that wants to kill your son. Go. And by faith, they started journeying the same journey as Abraham. By faith, they had to leave what they liked, what they knew, and survive in a different country, only to come back when they were called for more and more, you know, problems and issues. And we know by the time that Jesus died on the cross, his father wasn't there. We know that he probably died before then. For his mother was there at the foot of the cross. Can you imagine how, you know, how much blood was in her own dress? Because the blood was dripping down. Ever thought about that? Every year, last week I had the misfortune of missing something that I like to do. In Virginia Beach, every year they have what's called Messiah Sing-Along. How many of you know what that is? Yeah. Right? There in the Sanders Center, over 1,000 people or so get there and they all sing the Messiah. Well, I was on call for the hospital, so they called me and I couldn't go. But that is an amazing feat to be there and to hear the Messiah. It's not actually the Messiah, it's Messiah. As a violinist, way long time ago, I played in many orchestras, you know, playing the Messiah. It's a fantastic piece of work. But you know something? It was an amazing story of how this piece of work came to being. Because when we read it, it was incarnation, you know, in the life of Mary. It was the imperfect scenario. Sir John Hopkins said this about George Frederick Handel. He would frequently declare the pleasure he felt in settling the scriptures to music, and how contemplating the many sublime passages of the Psalms had contributed to his edification. By 1741, guess what was happening in America at the same time? George Frederick Handel was a failure, bankrupt, in great physical pain, and the victim of plots of sabotage. His career, the once great opera composer, scheduled a farewell concert there in England, and people started calling him this German nincompoop, as he once was called, was through. That summer, however, he composed Messiah, which not only brought him back into the spotlight, but is still deemed by some to be the epitome of the Christian faith. Handel was German born. He was born in Halle in 1685. When he was old enough, because he wanted to compose an opera, he moved to Italy at the invitation of the De Medici family, but unfortunately the Pope said, hey, no more operas. And the Pope, you know how that is in those times. So he had to move back to Germany, and then he moved then to London. In April 1737, at the age of 52, Handel seems to have suffered a stroke that rendered him totally, he couldn't use his right side, his leg, his right hand, and he was a classical pianist. And he couldn't even play, and he couldn't conduct anymore. He had to use his left hand. His right side was all blurred. The whole right side of his body was totally disabled. It was impossible for him to do anything. But that summer, he sat down, and someone by the name, now get it from that, Charles Jennens, gave him a little libretto. You know, in Spanish is a little book, and in Italian is just a book with things written about musicals. And in that little libretto, it was a story of the Messiah through the eyes of Isaiah. And it was divided into three different parts. First is all the prophecies dealing with the first coming of Jesus. And then the second part is the life of Jesus culminating in the cross. And that's when we see at the end the big song, you know, Hallelujah, the Hallelujah chorus. Hallelujah, you know, it's fantastic. But it also has a third section, which is all on the book of Revelation. The coming of Jesus Christ, how the heavens will split and all the plagues are going to hit, and how Jesus is going to come to redeem his people that second time. But we don't sing that last portion, the third portion of the Messiah. We only sing the first and second. And it says here, inspired, Handel decided he must compose an oratorio based on this libretto. The story of the composition is the most famous of all Christian musical works, as has been told. What we can say with certainty is that when he composed this whole thing in about 6 weeks. Can you imagine? How many of you have seen the book Messiah with all the scores for all the instruments and for all the choir? Soprano, alto, tenor, and bass. It's amazing. It's about this thick. I have it at home. He composed all of that in perfection in 6 weeks. All three sections of it. Today, of course, it's the only two parts that we sing. And in the Christmas performance, we also end with the Hallelujah. And the Hallelujah chorus is another interesting thing, how it came about. This tradition that when we sing the Hallelujah, what happens to everybody?
We stand up.
King George, who was also a German, he liked Frederick Handel, who was a German, but King George was the King of England at that time. And when he heard the Hallelujah chorus, he was so enamored with the thought that there was a king above him, that God was the king, that he stood up in awe when they sang that wonderful song. I mean, it just brings all kinds of hairs, you know, the ones that I'm missing, my son says. You know? He stood up in deference and in great awe of the king, and everybody saw this man stand up. So what they do is they all stood up with him, and until today that is practiced. It's interesting that John Wesley went to see the Messiah, and it's at the end of the Messiah he said, well, some parts are okay, it's not going to last. But Charles Wesley, who was a musician, and today we sing some wonderful hymns from Charles. In fact, one of his best known hymns is Hark the Herald's Angels Sing. That was Charles Wesley. He started visiting Handel and praying with Handel because he knew that this oratorio was something special. You know, Handel died, and he died with such a great, great feeling about the Messiah. In fact, in his score, in the original score, he wrote at the very end, he wrote S-D-G. He wrote that. And it was in Latin for Soli Deus Gloria. You know, when I look at the Messiah, the Christmas season, how personal it is to me, I think Handel had it right. To God only be what?
Glory.
Be the glory. Solo Deus Gloria. To God only be the glory. That is something very important that has been lost in the Christmas season of buying and buying and buying and receiving and receiving and receiving. You know, but in a personal way, is God in your life the whole purpose of your glory? It is amazing. So the mystery of the incarnation in a personal place is that we live to glorify
Amen.
God.
Amen.
We should live to glorify only, solo, Deus, our God. That is the message of Christmas, the New Year's, is for the next year. Let's live in a way that we give glory to God in our decisions, in our job, with our families. What is your tone of voice at home? Are you a caring individual? When your husband comes in through the door, do you run and give him a hug and a kiss and say thank you for everything you did? Or does the husband come home and says, dear, how many dishes do I need to do for you? Because in the likeness of Christ, we need to work for one another. And in the likeness of Christ, we should work for the ultimate goal to give God the glory in our lives, not ourselves. And in that spirit, let's all stand and let's enjoy the wonderful gift of serving one another at this moment. Let's all stand and let's just file out for the washing of the feet.